endless love, too vast and astounding to tell. Forever existing in worlds above, now offered and given to all. O fountain of beauty eternal, the Father, the Spirit, the Son, sufficient and endlessly generous, magnificent, marvelous, matchless love. Creation is brimming with thankfulness, the mountains exultant they stand, the seasons rejoice in your faithfulness, all life is sustained by your hand.
Welcome to our Good Friday Reflective Service. We are going to look at our wonderful, marvellous Saviour's story through the words of the prophet Isaiah, written some 700 years before Jesus was born. We're going to look at it in Isaiah 53. This chapter conveniently has four sections, and I propose that we look at each section at a time, and after each section we have a reflective prayer about that particular section. So if you'll turn with me to Isaiah 53, we will begin by reading verses 1 to 3. Who has believed our message, and to whom has the arm of the Lord been revealed? He grew up before him like a tender shoot, and like a root out of dry ground. He had no beauty or majesty to attract us to him, nothing in his appearance that we should desire him. He was despised and rejected by mankind, a man of suffering and familiar with pain, like one from whom people hide their faces. He was despised, and we held him in low esteem. A year ago, I suppose that if the people could see us now, they would not believe the story that we're in. we have the coronavirus and the whole world seems to have shut down. It is an unbelievable story. And in years to come, I'm sure that history books will write down this momentous occasion and the horrors therein. But it also reflects on the good things that came out of it. But this story is not the most unbelievable story in the world. The most unbelievable story is the story that we're considering today, that of Jesus. Jesus coming to this world, God coming as his Son, the Lord Jesus Christ, part of the triune God, was split so he could come down and live on this world and die on a cross for us. That's an unbelievable story. And that's why Isaiah says, who has believed our message? And to whom has the arm of the Lord been revealed? It was revealed to Isaiah 700 years before Jesus was born. And all the people that knew things in those days, the scholars of the time, would have known this was talking about the long-expected Messiah, the one that would lead them out of slavery, that would lead them to better times. This is the most unbelievable story. And then verse 2, it says, he grew up before him like a tender shoot and like a root out of dry ground. He had no beauty or majesty to attract him, us to him, nothing in his appearance that we should desire him. He had an ordinary beginning. In a way, it wasn't an ordinary beginning. He was born of the Virgin Mary. Of course, that was extraordinary and extremely difficult to take in for Mary at the time. But in another way, he had a very ordinary beginning. He lived in a little place called Nazareth, and Nazareth was concerned a backwater of society, somewhere where we would say, oh dear, you belong to that area. And in Ireland, there are many others. I won't mention any as not to offend anyone. But this was Nazareth. The Nazareth is a little town in a little province called Galilee, and it was very, very ordinary. And Jesus' life was very ordinary from plus 5 or 6 when he came to be living in Nazareth with his mum and his supposed dad, Joseph. But he was living as an ordinary carpenter's son. His whole demeanour was something that was nothing particular extraordinary about him. He had an ordinary beginning. He had no natural beauty that would attract us to him. You see, when he was announced on the hills of Bethlehem that Jesus was coming, they said this was the Messiah, the King of Kings, the Lord of Lords. And you would expect a lord and a king to have a palace. But no, Jesus was born in a stable, in a manger. Not for him a comfortable bed or a cot, a manger where animals fed. So from his very beginning, he had a very ordinary and mundane beginning. And then at 2 years old, he became a refugee, had to flee to Egypt for his life, as King Herod came to destroy all those young boys from 2 downwards because he was fearful of a new king. So this was a boy that had a very troubled upbringing, someone that didn't have the luxuries that we would have had in this day and age. He had an ordinary beginning, no natural beauty, but there was worse to come in verse 3. He was despised and rejected by mankind, a man of suffering and familiar with pain, like one from whom people hide their faces. He was despised, and we held him in low esteem. As I said, he came from Nazareth. He came from a place that wasn't particularly a popular place to come from. And you remember when he was gathering his disciples together, he spoke to Philip, and Philip went and spoke to his friend Nathanael. Nathanael was a little bit of a doubting person. He was quite a scholar. But when Philip said about, I found the Messiah, come and see him. And Nathanael was puzzled and said, can anything good come out of Galilee? This was his response. He was despised from the very beginning. I know that Nathanael came to love the Lord Jesus Christ. Of course he did, as one of his disciples. But from the beginning, he was rejected as a preacher, a teacher. He was despised by the authorities. He was a man of sorrow, and I'm sure there was many nights where he cried about the hardness of the hearts of those people he was telling about the kingdom of heaven. And he was familiar with pain. He didn't have anywhere to call his home. The Son of Man had nowhere to lay his head. He said, "Foxes have dens and the birds of the air have nests, but the Son of Man has nowhere to lay his head." He had no other comforts. He knew all about pain. So let's just have a word of prayer before we come to the next section. Oh Jesus, we thank you for what you gave up to come down to earth. Your glory and your triune communion. What a sacrifice. What a saviour. So let's look at this second section from verses 4 to 6. "Surely he took up our pain and bore our suffering, yet we considered him punished by God, stricken by him and afflicted. But he was pierced for our transgressions. He was crushed for our iniquities. The punishment that brought us peace with was on him, and by his wounds we are healed. We all, like sheep, have gone astray. Each of us has turned to our own way. The Lord has laid on him the iniquity of us all." Verse 4a says something amazing. Jesus was made a substitute sacrifice for us, something that God did for us because we could not do it. Verse 4a, "Surely you took up our pain and bore our suffering." He bore our suffering on the cross. When you look at the cross, what do you see? You see a man suffering, a man full of suffering, a sacrifice, the Holy Lamb of God sacrificed for our sins. But it's worse than that. It's worse than that. Someone hanging on the tree was bad enough, and we'll go into that later. But secondly, it says this, "Yet he considered him punished by God, stricken by him and afflicted." The punishment was not just by the Roman soldiers and the authorities. He was punished by his Father. He was punished by his Father because of our sins. And we'll look at that a little bit more detail later. He was there on the cross because of the sins that we have. The disobedience to God had caused him to be on the cross. Incredible. And then the third part. "But he was pierced for our transgression. He was crushed for our iniquities. The punishment that brought us peace upon was on him. And by his wounds we are healed." By his wounds we were healed. And what wounds? He was pierced, the very marrow of his soul. He was crushed for our sins. He was crushed in several ways. First, literally on the cross. People that know these things have said the cross was a very cruel punishment. And as the people were nailed or tied onto the cross, the pressure all came up from the bottom, and all the pressure came up under the heart until literally the heart exploded. He was crushed for us, and he did it for our sins. But he was also crushed because God had left him at that time, because he had our sins on us, put upon us, laid upon us, from us, sorry, he had all our sins from us put upon him. God couldn't look on him. God cannot look on sin. So God the Father turned his back on him. So he cried in dereliction, my God, why have you forsaken me?" And yes, there was silence in heaven, but he knew the answer. He knew the answer. It was because of us. So not only was he literally crushed on the cross and spiritually crushed on the cross, and also mentally he was alone there for the first time in his life. From all eternity to the new to eternity other, all the ages that you can think of and more beside, because he is an eternal God. He had no communion with the Father and the Holy Spirit. The triune God was ripped apart at that point. It's a mystery they can't totally understand, but it was necessary to give us peace through his suffering. He gave us peace because he was crushed for us, literally on the cross. But why was he done? Why was this necessary? Verse 6 tells us why. We all like sheep have gone astray. Each of us has turned to our own way, and the Lord has laid on him the iniquity of us all. Why? Because we like sheep have all gone astray. There is not one of us that live on earth, however good we are, that are perfect. We've all sinned, and God has the gold standard of a 100% believing and doing what he wants, what God wants and desires from us. And if we fall below that, we have sinned. We have fallen behind that standard. And we cannot have communion with God. And we cannot have a place in heaven. So that's why he did it, as a substitute sacrifice on the cross, so that we could have that route opened. As you look at the cross, on this side, say, is us, and that side is God. And Jesus is between us. And he has bridged that gap. That's why he had to do it. What a wonderful Saviour. Let's pray. Forgive us, Lord, that we feel put on or hard done by when we look at what you had to suffer and how you had to bear for us the punishment of the sin of those you redeemed by your blood. How you were pierced literally, mentally and spiritually, and how you were crushed on the cross under the weight of your body and grief. So much so that you shouted in pain, my God, why have you forsaken me? Lord, it was for us, and we are eternally thankful that you did not come down from the cross. Amen. So let's look at the third part of this in verses 7 to 9. He was oppressed and afflicted, yet he did not open his mouth. He was laid like a lamb to the slaughter, and as a sheep before its shearers is silent, so he did not open his mouth. By oppression and judgment he was taken away, yet who of his generation protested? For he was cut off from the land of the living. For the transgressions of my people he was punished. He was assigned a grave with the wicked, and with the rich in his death, though he had done no violence, nor was there any deceit in his mouth. He was silent and obedient out of love for us. He was always obedient to his Father and doing his will, but he was not always silent before his accusers. Think of all the times that he defended himself before the Pharisees and those of the law that thought they were better than him. And yet, at this time, from the Garden of Eden, from the Garden of Gethsemane through to the cross, he was silent before his accusers. When they came to arrest him in the garden, after Judas's betrayal and kiss, they all fell back when he said, I am he that you're looking for. He was still powerful enough. And he could have disappeared like he did on the hills before Nazareth when they were trying to push him over the hills there and kill him. He could have just disappeared. But he knew it was his time to be obedient and silent so that he'd go as the silent Lamb of God to die on the cross. And it was out of love for us that he did that. Do you remember his trial before Pilate? When he was there and Pilate was saying, why don't you defend yourself? Why are you silent before me? And Jesus said, you have power only because I give it to you. And he says, if this was my kingdom, was of this world, would not my disciples have defended? My kingdom is of another world. That is why I'm silent before you. It needs to be done. So that was wonderful, our marvellous, wonderful, obedient, silent Saviour. Then in verse 8 it goes on, by oppression and judgment he was taken away, yet who of his generation protested? He was cut off from the land of the living. For the transgressions of my people he was punished. Jesus' life was a short life. He didn't know anything about family and having children in that sense. He has many children through his blood, which is wonderful. But it was a short life. It was cut off. It was a man of about 33 years. A man that had known much sorrow, but much joy. But now he had this short life taken away from him. And he willingly went to the cross. So he willingly gave up his short life for us. What a saviour. But there was more to come in verse 9. He was assigned a grave with the wicked and with the rich in his death, though he had done no violence, nor was any deceit in his mouth. He was innocent, and yet he was crucified on a cross. And the Old Testament talks about being hung up on a wooden cross as being a shame and a curse. So he was our curse so that we could be right with God. He was cursed by God, as it were. He was taken and he was shamed. When you look at the cross, do you look at Jesus with clothes on? Brothers and sisters, he had no clothes. He was naked in many ways. Does that upset you? It upsets me as I think of my Saviour. The wonderful, marvellous Saviour that we have, dying on a cross, all alone, and shamed, naked. It's an awful death. He done it for the love of us. It's a shameful death. And he didn't even have his own grave, as was forecast in the Old Testament. He had a borrowed grave. The grave of a rich man, and he was buried there. It was a borrowed grave. He didn't have anything for himself. In this life he had nothing, and in his death he had nothing. What a saviour. How wonderful our Jesus is. The King of Kings, the Lord of Lords, the great King of this world, had nothing and died a shameful death because he loves us. And because he wants to have a relationship with us. He wanted to restore that relationship that was ruined in the Garden of Eden. What a saviour. What love. Let's have a word of prayer. Dear precious saviour, we can only imagine what pain you went through on the cross. We thank you that you were silent, obedient, O Lamb of God. We will worship you forever for what you have done. Behold the Lamb of God that taketh away the sins of the world, your cousin exclaimed. So we now worship and praise your holy name. Amen. So let's go on to the final piece, which is verses 10 to 12. Yes, yet it was the Lord's will to crush him, to cause him to suffer. And though the Lord makes his life an offering for sin, he will see his offspring and prolong his days, and the will of the Lord will prosper in his hand. After he has suffered, he will see the light of life and be satisfied by his knowledge, and my righteous servants will justify many, and he will bear their iniquities. Therefore I will give him a portion among the great, and he will divide the spoils with the strong. Because he poured out his life unto death, and was numbered with the transgressors. For he bore the sin of many, and made intercession for the transgressors. Verses 10 to 12 are wonderful, incredible, and expectant, and positive words to finish this passage on. First of all, in verse 10, it continues on this theme. Yet it was the Lord's will to crush him and cause him to suffer. And though the Lord makes his life an offering for sin, he will see his off- offspring and prolong his days, and he will of the Lord will prosper in his hands. You see, that's what I was alluding to just a little bit before. He will see his offspring. We are his offspring. We are his brothers and sisters. We are born again in Christ Jesus. You see how this works? He had to suffer. He had to die on the cross. He had to go into the grave, and he had to rise victoriously from the grave to show that he had conquered sin. And we are his offspring. It is a glorious future that he looks forward to and we look forward to through his suffering. Let's read the last two verses. After he had suffered, he will see the light of life and be satisfied. By his knowledge, my righteous servant will justify many, and he will bear their iniquities. Therefore, I will give him a portion among the great, and he will divide the spoils with the strong. Because he poured out his life unto death and was numbered with the transgression, for he bore the sin of many and made intercession for the transgressors. Isn't that incredible? The glorious future of Jesus as King of Kings. He told Pilate, this is not my kingdom. The earth is not my kingdom. I have another kingdom, the kingdom of heaven. And he will come again to bring him unto himself. Yes, he will come again. And we will reign eternally with him. And we will enjoy the fellowship with the Lord Jesus Christ. And we will enjoy the fellowship with the triune God. In perfect harmony, with no sin, no tears, no crying. Oh, praise the Lord. And this is all because of his sacrifice on the cross. This risen Saviour has extreme power. He eludes victory. And every time someone comes and turns to the Lord Jesus Christ, that's another victory, another son and daughter for the Lord Jesus Christ. He has a portion among the great. In fact, he is the greatest. Our whole system is tied up with him. 2020. Why? Because it's the beginning. It started at Jesus' birth. That's when the world really began again. And we have an eternity with him. We have an eternity with him. And before that comes into being, and it started now, into real being when he comes again and we reign with him and we're with him for eternity. I love those words of William Cowper. There is a fountain filled with blood drawn from Emmanuel's veins, and sinners plunged beneath that flood lose all their guilty stains. That's me and you, brother and sister. And it's anyone who comes to the Lord Jesus Christ. So finally, my plea is, if you haven't made that decision to follow Jesus, do it today as we remember what his sacrifice was for us. To finish with our final prayer. Magnificent, marvellous Saviour, we praise your name for your sacrifice on the cross. We glory in your amazing grace that kept you there until it was finished. And we rejoice in your resurrection as a sign you had conquered death once and for all, for all those who have been born again in you. And we, the redeemed of the Lord, can say with the Apostle Paul, where, O death, is your victory? Where, O death, is your sting? Amen.
That word.